church proclaims. May the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad. All your blessing comes that we may praise. May praise the name of Jesus. Holy, holy is the
everyone. Lovely to see you. Lovely that so many are already singing that song. And later on, we're going to put the music group to the test because they're going to be leading us without all the background percussion there. So, no pressure. The choir. And welcome to everyone. Lovely to see you all. Lovely to see your faces. And I know so many people are unwell at this time, but it's just a surprise that we are so many. But lovely to see you. And we're going to, I also want to welcome Rob. Rob Burns, always good when the speaker arrives. Rob is going to be sharing with us about Mission Links Wales and sharing God's word with us. It's good to see you, Rob. But we're going to start with a couple of songs. The first one is Come, Now is the Time to Worship. And it's one of my favourite starter songs because it means we come as we are. I'm not going to ask you right now to say how you are, but God knows. So however you are right now, now is the time for worship. So we're going to stand, we're going to sing that, Ellie's going to come and lead the singing, not me. And let's stand to sing.
Thank you.
let's just stay standing, shall we, and let's pray. Lord God, how wonderful it is that we can come just as we are to worship you. You know, each of us, you know what's going through our minds, through our hearts, whether we're filled with joy or really battling with life. But Lord, we thank you. We've come here today to meet with each other and to meet with you. And we ask that today you will speak. Today you will minister into our hearts and souls. And anyone who's watching this service later on a video would be touched as well. We pray a blessing over your church today. And we thank you that we can worship with the church worldwide, the church that has met throughout ages. And we can now sing a song that was written hundreds of years ago, and even the second tune written hundreds of years ago. And we can worship with the saints. Amen.
Amen.
Something God is doing, and we're meant to notice it. And here again, from the New Testament, Jesus said, and he said it to the scribes and Pharisees who were always getting it wrong, and he said to them, look, when evening comes, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red, and in the morning, today it will be stormy, for the sky is red and overcast. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. And basically, he was telling them off, because they should have realized what was going on, because he'd come. So I hope that when we see daffodils, we'll also remember to put the light on. I hope that we'll remember to look out for the things God is doing as well, and perceive those. So in a moment, I think, is it Joy? Joy is, look, she's got her Ello top on specially, is going to be taking the children out for Oggies, and it's time for the notices for everyone else. So Joy, do you want to stay for the notices, or do you want to go straight away? Stay for the notices. Where are you at?
I think she said,
there we
go.
Oh, my God. You guys, yeah. You're going to find your weddings in the meanwhile, but here's the notices for the week. So tonight, a church meeting for the church members. That's at 5 o'clock here in the church. Tomorrow, coffee and cake. And Suzanne is going to be sharing with us about who has the key. All of our talks are about homes and houses. So Suzanne tomorrow. Bible study and prayer Tuesday and Thursday with Alan. That's exciting as we move into to Chronicles. Alpha on Wednesdays at Ricky and Paul's. And then the writing group with Chrissy on Thursday. But you're full up, aren't you, Chrissy? You're full up. But we'll be thinking of you. Lighthouse Friday at 5. Then Hot Topics, 7 o'clock on March 26th. Heaven and or hell. That's a hot topic, isn't it? So put that one in your diary too. So now I think, where's Alan? Alan, you're going to take the offering, I think, which is lovely. And the music group are happily going to play something while that happens. For this, but for all the other mothers that he has to handle and the bills and everything. But
Lord, we thank you for all the blessings that you shine upon us every moment of the day. And Lord, we just ask that we accept these gifts, which you humbly give to you, Lord. It's just a thank you for what you do for us. And Lord, we ask that you guide us in how we use this money for your sake and your will. For we ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Rob. Rob's going to be sharing a little bit about Mission Links Wales, of which this church is linked in. So if you know nothing about Mission Links, you're now going to find out all about it and what's happening as Rob shares with us.
Great. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I recognise a lot of you, but... some of you might be hearing this for the very first time, so I've put these on your tables. So, you know, we don't ask for our life. Sometimes it feel like it's dealt to us, don't we? You know, and what it does is unique things come to our life, and we've got to ask, say, hey, God, how might you use those things, you know? And so for me, I began life as a professional footballer. So I signed for Wolves when I was 16, and I started to go down that route, much to the chagrin of my father, who wanted me to become a lawyer, because he was a business law professor. But when I was 19, they let me go, and I went off to university finally, to the business law degree that he wanted, but of course, no, I wanted to do a sports degree. And so he called it a degree in jogging for the rest of his life. So I have a degree in jogging. The fact, when I did an MA in theology, he was kind of finally impressed. But degree in jogging. My son's got a degree in jogging, he used to say. When he was 18. So, funny man. And so I went off then, after I'd finished university, to the United States to play soccer. I was a Christian by then. You know, I had a big life change when I was 23. A lady who became my wife led me to the Lord, and big changes. So went to play, but I was a Christian. Began to share the Christian faith while I was a player and also as a coach. And we began to develop a coaching program that taught 6,000 kids a week eventually. It still exists today, actually, in Houston. So Houston and Dallas was where that was. So we would share the Christian message through the game of soccer, and kids and parents and youth would begin to receive the Lord. It was wonderful. Then I went to seminary, got the MA in theology, and was sent as a missionary. Now I know I've got this accent, but I was sent by American churches to Wales as a missionary. So I'm this hybrid person. So I'm an ordained American Baptist kind of minister. So sent here as a missionary, still a missionary today. And I don't know, I suppose I've always had a link with the US ever since I was 25, so 35 years now, spoke to an American every day, either an American colleague, a missionary, or an American pastor, or someone from seminary, or a university professor who I went to seminary with. And do you see? So I've had this link with the USA for 35 years, but I've lived here for 23 years. So there's lots of links here. For instance, I've known Jenny and Mike for nearly 15 years or so. I was working it out the other day. Been here a long time, you know. It's been a pleasure to get to know Dom and, you know, and the whole team here as we've been doing that. And so the Lord began to say to me in about 2010, look, you seem to have this link with the United States. You seem to have this strong link with Wales. Wales needs a little bit of help. I think we could admit that. We need some help with our Christian. We need some kind of people, some enthusiasm into our midst. How about if you partner your American friends, pastors, missionaries, university people, with your Welsh friends in Wales? And we began to set up Missional Links Wales. And that's what you see on your tables. We exist, pick it up if you want. We exist to initiate and facilitate missional relationships, providing ongoing support, missional training, and consultancy to Welsh and US charities. That's what we exist to do. And we do it, if you turn over the page, by 1 week mission trips. So that's what you had last year. You've joined in the Missional Links Wales partnership. North Fort Worth Baptist Church is your partner. You and about nine other Vale churches, and you work together across the Vale, doing all sorts of fantastic things. It went great, didn't it? We were all so enthused by it. We reached quite a lot of people, which was great. And that's happening again this summer. But also, if you turn over there, look, also through interns. So we've been bringing interns now for nearly 20 years. So over 200 interns between the age of 18 through 25. They come for a year. They work in the churches. They're enthusiastic. They get stuck in, you know. And then also through missionaries, 26 through 55. So we've got a missionary coming in September, who's 27, as well as interns. But also consultants. Last year, we had a 57-year-old retired police officer, a woman, who came and worked as a community worker in Anon Baptist Church in North Cardiff. Did the most fantastic missionary work. It was awesome. So they come at all ages, 18 through 80. I don't mind, as long as they're healthy and as long as they're enthusiastic, as long as they'll work with you guys. And then we also bring teachers in, people who will come in and kind of share, come out, work with pastors and encourage pastors. So that's what Missional Links Wales does. Pray for us, because there's been some wonderful things happening in 2022. You know, I wondered whether Missional Links Wales was going to exist in 2020 and 2021, you can imagine. If the mission is about bringing people from one country to another and travel is closed down across the world, you get worried, right? And so I would walk in the fields where I live in Tongwydlais and say, Lord, do you want this back? Am I supposed to do something else? But no, he said, keep on walking. Keep on working with those Welsh churches. Keep on working with those US churches. And I began to do that. To set up a partnership usually takes around 15 months. You know, there's a lot to do, isn't there? Imagine, 6,000 miles away, an American church and Welsh churches. To set up one normally takes about 15 months. How about if I told you we've set up three brand new ones in 2022 alone? Three. And they're on the ground and ready to come in 2023. I want you to pray for me though. Pray for Missional Links Wales. In order for us to bring interns, we have to get next to interns. And the way that we get next to interns is to get into universities. And so we look to form memorandums of understandings, in other words, relationship agreements, official, that are signed, that that individual American universities will promote Missional Links Wales and its internships to their students. Now imagine promoting your course to thousands of students, all right? So we look to get these memorandums of understanding. In 2021, we did our very first one, our very first memorandum of understanding. Now, we've been out to the universities for years. They've been providing. But a memorandum of understanding puts our brochure in the mission office. And so when that young person walks into the mission office and gets the brochure, now that's a proper relationship, isn't it? As a result of the last visit, I came back 2 weeks ago. we're looking to set up three more memorandums of understanding. One with Louisiana Christian University, one with Oklahoma Baptist University, and one with Dallas Baptist University. That's about 22,000 students. Now, they're not all Christians, and they're not all going to want to come to Wales, but imagine the young person feels called to mission, that they walk into the mission office, and they get that brochure. Not bad, huh? That gives us an opportunity to bring those people to Wales in a way that we've never done before. So, praise the Lord with me for 2022. Three brand new partnerships, North Cardiff, Newport, and Rhondlechin and Taff. And pray for those relationships with those three new universities, Dallas Baptist University, Oklahoma Baptist University, and Louisiana Christian University, that might yield interns that might come into your church and other churches in the Vale. So would you pray for me? You've got these up now, put them on your fridge, and when you walk to get a glass of milk, you see Mission All Links Wales, just send up a 30-second prayer for us. Would you do that? God bless you.
I'm not sure how many times that Rob said pray for us there, but we should pray, shouldn't we? So let's just bow our heads in prayer, shall we? Well, thank you for Rob's amazing testimony and the incredible open doors you've given him, particularly, Lord, with those American churches and those American young people. Lord, we can't imagine those kind of meetings. But Lord, we do know that here in Wales, that we are part of the same church, and Lord, that you want to do wonderful things here in Wales. And Lord, so we thank you for the churches in the Vale of Glamorgan that are partnered, and other places in Wales that are partnered with one another too. And we really pray for the churches in Wales, Lord, that you would give guidance about how these links work, and what small, what large things you want to happen. And Lord, we also pray for a blessing for our American brothers and sisters. And we pray, Lord, they're busy praying for us, but we pray for them. And Lord, we pray for a great blessing upon the American church. And we know that the American church isn't without its issues, its problems. And Lord, we know that you are the same God who wants to guide and bless them. So we pray a blessing over the American church. And pray, Lord, for it to be totally focused on you, and an understanding of what you are doing in these days. So bless them, we pray too. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Okay, so next we have, let me see here. Yes, there are readings. Sue, are you happy to come out and do this reading, or would you like to do it from there? Come on out. Sue's going to bring a reading next.
I'm doing Matthew 16, I thought I was doing Matthew 13. I was doing the latter one, I think.
Sorry?
I was doing this one. This is the one you want me to do now.
Yes, please.
Yeah. Thank you. Matthew 13, verses 10 to 17. The disciples came to him and asked, "Why do you speak to the people in parables?" He replied, "Because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. This is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear nor understand. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You will be ever hearing, but never understanding. You will be ever seeing, but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become callous. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, because they see, and your ears, because they hear. For truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it."
Thanks. Thank you, Sue, and I'm sorry for the muddle about the readings. And I think if the musicians want to come back, we will be just singing again one more time, the Lord speaks to us. But you'll notice that all the scriptures have been about the need to use our eyes, to use our ears, and to see and to hear and to understand what the Lord would show us. And do you remember, he did speak in parables. They're not things that are too difficult for us to understand. So we have to have ears to hear and hearts that will understand. But in a moment we're going to sing a lovely song, To Be In Your Presence, and I'll pass the microphone over to Sue again for that. But first of all, I just want to read a poem which I read during the week, and this is it's called An Ode to an iPhone. So hopefully you've got a picture here behind us of the iPhone, because iPhones have become so much part of our lives, haven't they? So here it is, An Ode to an iPhone. I don't want to be distracted or to distance myself away from your presence, but I so often find myself scrolling, searching, swiping, adding to cart and refreshing. Evenings of channel hopping and WhatsApp swapping, and yet another day goes by with not so much exchange between you and I. I don't want that to be our story, one of disconnect and untold glory. I want to be captivated and connected, my heart attuned to yours. But it seems that history repeats itself as an apple gets in the way.
Let's today follow this wonderful theme that Jenny's laid out for us of new things, you know, new things, because there are new things coming our way. We never get too old for God to do new things in our life. Never. He's always doing new things. It might not be jumping out of a plane. It might not be like parasailing down a mountain. But there's always new things. Always new things coming our way. In the last 2.5 years, the world has changed profoundly. Every country, every city, every town, every village, every family, every individual has been affected by these new things. These things that have come our way. God's allowed a pandemic to sweep across the world like an avalanche. It's touched every aspect of our society, including government and business, education, the third sector. Nothing and no one has escaped its reach. Everyone's been affected in one way or another. And I know people have differing views of it, but World Health Organization statistics, January 2023, said that 660 million cases of COVID have come into the world and 6.7 million deaths due to COVID. And the cases keep growing and the deaths continue. In addition, Russia has invaded Ukraine. In Eastern Europe, there's been devastating bushfires in Australia. There's been floods in Indonesia, earthquakes in China, India, Iran, Philippines, Russia, and recently Turkey. How horrible was that? There's been massive swarms of locusts in Asia, in East Africa, and in the Middle East. And there's been fantastic things happening. In April 2021, NASA's Ingenuity became the first vehicle, did you read about it, to fly in the atmosphere of another planet. That's awesome, isn't it? And how about Mr. Zoom, Eric Yuan? I'd love to see his big bag balance, wouldn't you? We've all learned to do Zoom. And we use Zoom now as a communication method. God's got our attention. He's got our attention mainly through this devastation and this suffering that's come to our world. But there are good things happening as well. And 1,300 years ago, a highly trained man of royal blood, a fearless and visionary prophet called Isaiah. We've read about him already today. Isaiah means Jehovah saves. That's a great positive name, isn't it? Jehovah saves. And he's speaking into the lives of a disobedient people. Of a hard-nosed people, the people of Judah in the southern kingdom. He's telling them off. In the first 39 chapters of the book, he speaks of Judah's doom. God's had enough. You're going into Babylon. You're going to go into exile. And they did in 586. But in chapter 40, he gloriously shifts to the restoration now. And after that exile, he says, after we've learned our lessons, he says, after the suffering, he's going to bring you out. And he's going to bring a Messiah king. And he tells them the comfort is coming on the way. In chapter 40, he said there'd be one where a voice. He said there'll be one whose voice cries out in the wilderness. That's John the Baptist, isn't it? It's a prophecy of John the Baptist. And he'd come and prepare us for the Messiah. And then in chapter 42... he says, then there'd come one who wouldn't cry out. He'd just come and get the job done. And we know who that is, don't we? That's the Messiah himself. He'd bring justice to the Jewish nation and the rest of the world would put their hope in him. And then in chapter 43, Isaiah tells the Judeans that God would eventually redeem them and bring them out from the Babylonians. After the suffering, there'd be a new thing. He said God would call them by name. He claimed them as his own, and neither the waters or the fires would destroy them. And he'd do a new thing in their life. And then in Isaiah 43:18, we're going to read it again in two versions. Jenny's already played it. He said this in the NIV first. Forget the former things. This is what we're going to talk about today. Do not dwell on the past. See, I'm doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I'm making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. I like it in the Message, though. In the Message, Eugene Peterson says it like this. Forget about what's happened. Don't keep going over old history. Be alert. Be present. I'm about to do something brand new. It's bursting out Don't you see it? There it is. I'm making a road through the desert. Rivers in the Badlands. Poetic. I love Eugene Peterson. So what is Isaiah urging the Judeans and you and I to do here and now? Well, first, he's saying this: accept what's happened and see suffering as preparation for something new. Look what that says on the screen. Accept what's happened and see suffering as preparation for something new. Yes, the Judeans were going to be in captivity for 70 years. They'd be badly persecuted. They'd be separated from their families. They'd be humiliated. They'd be humbled as well, and they'd learn some lessons. But God would eventually bring them out. When? And when, not if, by the way, the fires came into their lives. When the floods came, when the devastation of the exile would come. After that, there'd be new roads and new rivers and new pathways for them to journey with him. And the Holy Temple, of course, would then be built by Ezra. But you know, this wasn't the only time, biblically, that the people suffered. This is a pattern. And this is what I want to talk about today. Suffering, then a new thing, is a biblical pattern. Let me remind you of a few. After 400 years in Egyptian slavery and drudgery, God did a new thing. And he brought the Israelites out, not across, but through the Red Sea. From suffering came a new thing. After 13 years of abandonment and slavery in prison, God did a new thing. And he raised Joseph from the prison to the palace and made him prime minister. And he even had the poise to say to his brothers, "What you meant for evil, God meant for good." From suffering to new thing is a biblical pattern. After 13 years on the run from Saul, Paul did a new thing, and he raised David to king, and he became the best king that Israel ever had. And at the end of the book, Malachi prophesies that there'd be another Elijah that would come in the form of John the Baptist, like I said, but then the Messiah would come. He'd do something new. He'd bring the Savior, King Jesus, who'd live a perfect life, die a perfect death, and rise again to come and live in you and live in me and do a new thing. From suffering comes a new thing. And it's a principle in the modern world. Did you know, I don't know whether any of you like Kentucky Fried Chicken. I mean, I like a little bit of it. Colonel Sanders was 62 years old. And that's why what I wanted to say to you today. He was 62 years old when he first began to pitch that wonderful recipe that's irresistible, isn't it? Over 1,000 restaurants rejected Colonel Sanders. And then one in Utah said yes. And the rest is history. Edison tried 1,000 times, over 1,000 times, with the light bulb. Einstein couldn't read till he was 9 years old. 9 years old. Henry Ford went bankrupt 5 times until he made a car. In any color you want, as long as it was black. We all know that one, don't we? Apparently, Walt Disney lacked imagination. And apparently, Fred Astaire couldn't sing or act, but he could dance moderately. These are what these people were told. I could go on and on and on. And you know, every single one of you sitting in your seats today, and I know as well, that anything that I've ever achieved has come through suffering first, has come through difficulty first. Anything worth having comes through suffering first before the new thing arrives, because that's what makes it joyous. Because it was hard. And we overcome, and we come through it. And so here we are in a world that's recovering after COVID. Oh, there are new things ahead. There are still difficulties in the world. There's energy prices, we know that. And there's rapid inflation and there's turmoil. We know that it's not perfect, but God is doing a new thing. He's beginning to lift our heads, and through the suffering, we're beginning to see a new life and a new world, just as Jenny has been sharing with us today. It's God's pattern. It's God's pattern in your life. It's God's pattern in my life. But I ask you today, how can we prepare? It's a good question, isn't it? How might we prepare? Well, may I suggest that we ask ourselves three basic, important, foundational questions that we can all ask ourselves and keep asking ourselves. I started to ask these questions in COVID in about 2021, began to ask these questions of myself. And I'm going to share with you today. I'm going to be vulnerable with you. I'm going to share some of the things that the Lord has come out or shared with me as I've asked myself these three questions. And I'm going to ask the same thing to you. The first question is, what do I need to stop? What do I need to stop? No one's the finished product. You're not the finished product because you're retired, or you're not the finished product because you're turning 60, which I'm going to do soon, right? You're not the finished product. What do you need to stop? What is it in your life that's harming your relationship with yourself? Relationship with others? Relationship with your friends? Relationship with your wife or husband? Relationship with God? What's harming it? What personal habits have you developed that hinder your walk? What have I developed? And Jenny, I've developed a phone addiction. Over time, and it got worse in COVID, I am that person you spoke about in that poem. I've realized that I don't just rely on my phone to make calls, not just to surf the net or email. When there's a space in my life, as the poem said, I reach for my phone. I didn't used to do that. I reach for my phone. When I'm in that queue, when I could be talking to someone, and could be related to someone, could be sharing Jesus with someone, I'm on my phone. I fill the spaces in my life with that phone. And it's got to stop. My wife began to say to me in about 2021, 2022, are you present with me now or are you in Rob's world? And that's not good. That's not good. And so I'm working with Jenny, and I've been doing it now for 18 months, where she restricts my phone, and I promise her that I... Not Jenny, my Jenny, that's right. Yes, we know, my wife's called Jenny. So I'm working with Jenny, and what we do is this, we restrict me, and I'm just being honest with you now, we restrict me to 30 minutes a day on Auto Trader. That's my sin, I'll tell you. Auto Trader, I have 30 minutes, that's all I have, and I promise Jenny that I won't press that another 15 minutes. Which you can get. I won't do it. I have 1 hour on Safari. That's all I have. And there are various other restrictions that we do. I need to stop. And I need to get back with my eyes open, aware of what's going on around me, so that I can be a better witness with the Lord. And apparently, by the way, I'm not on my own. In 2022, Business Insider did a survey. And they said that the average iPhone user touches their phone more than 2,000 times a day. So maybe I'm not on my own in the room, I don't know. That's my thing, and I need to stop it. And I'm beginning to address it. What do you need to address? What do you need to stop? To prepare for something new. For that thing that the Lord's going to bring into your life after all this suffering, after all this stuff. What do you need to stop? To prepare for the new thing that the Lord's bringing in your life. Second question I'm asking myself, and he's asking us, is this. What do you need to start? What do you need to start? What has the Lord been whispering to your heart and your mind for months, even years, to start doing that you're not doing? Maybe it's a regular quiet time and Bible reading. Maybe it's more regular exercise. Maybe it's more quality time with your spouse, or with a certain friend, with your grandkids, with your kids. Maybe it's more conversations with people at work about your spiritual life. Maybe it's, I don't know, maybe it's to serve more in the local church. I don't know what it is, but what do you need to start? He's whispering to you. He's whispering to your heart. He's whispering to your mind. He's been whispering to me to take more responsibility with my house. I'm just telling, being honest with you today. In the past, I blamed my father. I blamed the fact that he didn't teach me and he didn't do much DIY. Because he was a professor. He had many, many students who loved him. And all he had to do was call and say, look, my washing machine's broken. And they'd say, oh, Professor Burns, I'll come over. I'll fix it for you right away. To him, the answer to DIY was a phone. But I don't know the people he knows. But I've always said, well, my father didn't teach me. It's rubbish. It's an excuse. And I need to take more care with my house. And so over these last 2 to 3 years, I'm not a skilled person in any way. But when I've got a tradesman in, I ask them questions. Say, how do you do that? And what did you do there? What tools would I need if I did that myself? And as I do that, it's something I need to start. And I want you to know I've started to clean more and repair a few simple things that I've never done in my whole life. Because I'm not a DIY guy. Now, you might be sitting there thinking, what planet is that guy on that he can't fix stuff? But I've got my stuff, you've got your stuff. What do you need to start? What do you need to stop? What do you need to start? That's what I need to start. And I'm beginning to address it. And then the third question, what do I need to strengthen? What are you doing regularly that you feel God's pleasure when you do it? There's something about you that he does. He works with your personality uniquely. He works with you, kind of, he puts you in certain places. And it's just, you know, there's a flow of God when you're doing these things. You're already good at it. God already uses you in it. But if you did it more, it would be even more fruitful. What do you need to strengthen? Maybe it's to share your faith more with an unbelieving friend. Maybe it's to be kinder to your wife or husband or your neighbor. I don't know what it is. What do you need to do more of? Because you're already doing it. But when you do it more, it'll be even more fruitful. For me, it's to get more and more involved in coaching and mentoring and personal evangelism. I share with people. It just comes out from me. I can't help it. If I'm on a train, I share. But get off your phone, Rob, and do it more. Do it more. I mentor people. I've already got people I mentor and I coach. Could I add one more or two more to coach and to bring those 60 years to bear on another person's life? Something that I already do. But could I do more? One more. Or two more. You know what you're good at. You know how the Lord uses you in a special way. Could you do it a little bit more? What do I need to start? What do I need to stop? What do I need to strengthen? Søren Kierkegaard, the 19th century Christian philosopher in Denmark. One day he felt like he had a download from the Lord to speak to the Danish nation about the state of Christianity in that country. And it's become something that has spread across the world. It's a beautiful illustration. And I've brought that illustration into kind of, let's just call it the 21st century. He tells the story of a flock of domestic geese who live contentedly in the farmyard. Most of them would hungrily eat from the plentiful supply that the farmer provided and the warm barns. They would go and stay in those warm barns overnight. Most of these domestic geese had very few cares, and they'd chatter amongst themselves, discussing the quality of the food and the warmth of the barns, and they'd gossip about the other geese. They lived an idyllic life. Now, once a week, they'd collect in the corner of the yard, and they'd sit down in the shade of a tall oak tree, and the gander, the elder goose, would tell them a story. One day the gander told those domestic geese about the wild geese that didn't live on the farm. They had wings. They could soar into heaven. They weren't contained by the small horizon of the farm. Their horizon was the open sky. Their food was what nature provided. If they couldn't find it, they'd fly and find where the food was. if they couldn't find shelter. They'd fly and go out and find the shelter. If the weather grew cold and the food became scarce, they would fly to a brand new place all together. All of the geese were inspired by this. They were proud of their wild geese, brothers and sisters. What faith, they'd said. What bravery, what courage, what strength and fortitude those wild geese have, they would say. But then they go back to their usual ways. However, some of the geese began to eat less, gossip less, exercise more. Running around the outside of the farmyard to get fitter. Because they wanted, next time the wild geese came over, to fly out with them. The other geese would gather in the middle of the barn and they'd talk about the geese that were running around the farmyard. They'd say, what on earth are they doing? They're not enjoying the food like us. They're not enjoying the warm barns like us. The wild geese won't even notice them when they fly over. What are they doing? And then one day in October, there was some excitement in the farmyard. The geese who'd been exercising and staying healthy saw some wild geese flying overhead. They scurried and they ran and they hopped and they rose to the heavens, shouting goodbye to the domestic geese. And they were never seen again by the domestic geese. Because in late November, though the domestic geese would try to fly, when the farmer came towards them with his knife, it was too late and their goose was cooked. God is doing a new thing. A new thing in you and a new thing in me. Let's make sure we don't miss it. We're never too old. We're never too comfortable. God does new things in us all the time. There's always somebody new to speak to. There's always a new project that he has for you. There's always a new plan for you. It isn't enough to be stirred by something. You've got to act. And I've got to act. Let's not be taken by surprise like those comfortable, overweight, unprepared domestic geese. Let's be prepared. Let's be fit. Let's be ready to fly. May the COVID events teach us that suffering is preparation for something new. It's a biblical principle. It's a life principle. It's our principle for our life. And so, as you see these questions now on the screen, what do I need to stop? What do I need to start? What do I need to strengthen? I've shared mine. How about you? And so we're going to have 60 seconds. I just want you to just bow your heads and close your eyes for a second. And we're just going to have a bit of time with the Lord. Just silence with the Lord. Lord speaking to you and your thing. Your thing's your thing. My thing's my thing. And just let the Lord speak on these three questions. What do I need to stop? What do I need to start? What do I need to strengthen? Let's have some silence now. Amen. May the Lord encourage you, provoke you, prepare you, and challenge you for your new season. God is not finished with you yet, and neither is he finished with me. God bless you.
So we come now to our communion together, and it's been wonderful just to have that pause there. And we have a song that goes with that pause as well, so that we're not losing everything you've just shared with us, because those are the things the Lord is writing into our hearts. But we're going to sing now, Be Still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here, because we want him to speak even more deeply into our hearts. And then I'm going to read a scripture as we go into communion together, if that's all right. Ellie, do you want to come and sing? Created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. This is the gospel that you have heard and that is being proclaimed to every creature under heaven. Our Jesus. And we come to the communion, and as we do so, we want to welcome everyone who knows and loves the Lord. And if for any reason you don't want to take communion, please just remain seated and let it all happen around you. But we are coming into the Lord's presence. And if we claim to be without sin, then we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. So let's just take a moment to pray and to reflect and to examine ourselves. And the scripture says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." And when Jesus died on the cross, his last words were not "it is finished," but "tetelestai," which does mean "it is finished." Those were the words Jesus said. At the time when prisoners were incarcerated, the charge sheet was often nailed to the door, listing all their crimes. And when they had finished their sentence, the word "tetelestai" was written over it. "It is finished, you've served your sentence." And the same word was put on receipts to show that the bill had been fully paid. And on the cross, Jesus said, "Tetelestai," it is finished. He has put an end to our sins. He's paid the price, paid the sentence through his own blood for us. So today, as we come as one body, to share in a symbolic meal of bread and wine, we do so in fellowship with one another, but to proclaim his death, which we know was for us, and his resurrection until he comes again. So this communion is for all who love the Lord and want to know him more. Even if you know that you're trusting in Jesus for the very first time today. So Ellie and Dom are going to come to the table now and help me as we serve you. Thank you so much. That's lovely. And on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus had a meal with his friends. He took a loaf of bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it. This is already being broken for us. And he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance for me." And then after the meal, could you just wait a minute? Then after the meal, Jesus then took the wine and said, "This, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, drink it in remembrance of me." And Ellie is now just going to pray for us. Then the bread will be brought. Do take the bread when it's brought to you. Just receive that yourselves. But then please retain the cup when that comes to you, because we're going to stand, if we can, and we're going to drink together. So Ellie, would you pray for that both for us? Thank you.
Lord, we come before you today full of thanks for this gift. Lord, we pray that we won't come with distracted or insincere hearts, but that as we eat and drink the bread and wine, which symbolize Jesus' body and blood, that we will be struck with reverence and true praise. The man of sorrows who bore our suffering, who bore our pain, took our punishment. Lord, I pray that as we eat and drink, we will be filled with thanksgiving and love. Amen. Amen.
Shall we stand together? Jesus, who died for us and is risen and will come again. Amen. And please do take your seats. And I'm going to do something a little unusual. So, while we're still, while we have just celebrated all that Jesus has done for us, I'm just so aware that as a church we know that we have many missing people here. And some are here, and it's wonderful that they're here today, but they still need a lot of prayer. You know who you are. But, I mean, maybe even if you would dare to, if you know that you need an extra prayer today, just raise your hand, because we're going to pray for those in the fellowship, those who are not well. And if you know that even though you look like you're okay, you're not, just raise your hand. Someone in will just notice it and pull out a friendly hand. I know that there's a couple here, it's wonderful. I hope somebody's going to reach out a hand to you guys at the back there. But let's just pray for those that we know, we love, that would normally be here with us, and pray for them right now. So Jesus, we thank you. You are present here with us, Lord. We pray that at the beginning of the service, and Lord, we know that we are in your presence now. So together we pray. And we pray for those that we know right now are really struggling. Jesus, I just thank you because I know that for Gloria and Isabel, it's a miracle that they're here today. I pray for them. We pray for them. We pray, Lord Jesus, for their bodies as they are battling with ill health. But we pray for your victory over their lives. Thank you. You want us to be well in body, mind, and spirit. And we pray for them when their bodies have been letting them down recently. And we pray that your encouragement, your blessing, your healing will be upon them. We pray for Sean as she has really battled through a difficult operation and there's a lot further to go for her. But we pray for healing for Sean's body and that it would be such a blessing within the family but also within the fellowship and the village here. We pray for her. We pray for others who have got minor things at one level. We pray for everyone who's not here today who would normally be here. And we also pray for Phoebe and Davy and their family. We know around now they're going off on a bit of an adventure to seek your will for the future. We pray your blessing upon them too and ask that you would go with them and give them journey mercies and help them to have a wonderful time away, but bring them back, Lord, to with full knowledge of what your plan is for the future. Lord, you know the challenges that are before us. You know the things you have shown each of us to stop, to start, or to strengthen. And Lord, we give you thanks that by your Holy Spirit you are willing to work with us just as we are and to bring about your good and perfect will. So we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And on the screen, I think we have a... Go right forward to a prayer. Let's just say this together, shall we? Lord, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, and we ask you now to send us out into the world to live and work to your praise and glory. And we're going to attempt saying the grace to one another now. If you know this, it's a lovely thing to look at someone else and look at as many people as you can rather than just one person. If you've never said the grace, then just let it be said to you. So let's keep our eyes open and look round at this wonderful fellowship that we have together and say together, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Thank you. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. And thank you, Rob, for your message.
Yes.
Amen.